To develop and strengthen a nation, education should be prioritized as a pioneer. Currently, learning society and lifelong learning are inevitable trends that we should pay much attention to enrich Vietnamese generations. Founded in 1990 and formerly being a state university since 2006, Ho Chi Minh City Open University is a multidisciplinary university providing a wide range of subjects in both undergraduate and postgraduate levels with training modes of tradition and distance education. As one of the leading providers of distance education in Vietnam, Ho Chi Minh City Open University is proud of itself to offer the education programs across the country of Vietnam. There are more than 14,000 students of the traditional programs and 40,000 students of off-site programs, and more than 600 staff and faculty members working and learning at the school. To meet the needs of learners and to support the teaching of lecturers, infrastructure of Ho Chi Minh City Open University is equipped with the latest technology and upgraded annually. Classrooms are always standardized and with conditions of temperature, air, light, sound, and other facilities. The spacious campuses are qualified with
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to draw your attention to the stage to enjoy the unique performance of the music band first established in October 2017. They made a strong impression on all of the audiences on the 15th International TESOL Conference AsiaCom 2017. Also, they organized a memorable concert in late January 2018 to raise money for charity in an effort to support underprivileged students, but whose academic performance were excellent. And now please welcome the music band, the OU lecturers. Thank you.
Confess, and please don't tell me. Collapse, collapse. like you don't, dear. Confess, and please don't tell me.
Participants who demand an official seal on your business paper proving your participation in our conference. Please proceed to the desk placed outside this main hall. Thank you for your attention. Also, please be noted that our conference today is broadcast live on Facebook. You can get access to our Facebook, OpenTESOL International Conference. One more thing, please keep your name tag with you so that you can join the lucky draw by the end of this conference. Therefore, please remain to the end of the conference so that you can win our biggest prize worth less than 10 million Vietnam dong. Thank you.
Distinguished guests, keynote speakers, lecturers, participants, students, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 6th OpenTESOL International Conference. With the theme, Language Learning and Teaching Transformation in the Post-Modern Era.
Ho Chi Minh City Open University is honored to host this TESOL conference. It aims at establishing a quality hub for sharing ideas of appropriate pedagogies in different teaching and learning contexts, providing an opportunity for building a network of teachers and those professionals involved in language teaching, strengthening the ties between the foreign language teaching communities in Ho Chi Minh City and other provinces in Vietnam, connecting local communities with international language education institutions or associations, presenting state-of-the-art research into language and language education.
And ladies and gentlemen, first of all, it is my honor to introduce to you the keynote speakers at the conference today. Professor Minh from Nagoya University, Japan.
Associate Professor Lê Văn Cảnh, Vietnam National University, Hanoi.
Dr. David Thong Pao, University of Agriculture and Veterinary Medicine in Hobiviro, Hokkaido, Japan.
We would also like to introduce to you our sponsor today, Ms. Diane Miller from Regional English Language Office, U.S. Embassy in Vietnam.
And the representatives from the publishing houses, Ms. Jung Kunan and Ms. Jung Hui, you jump from Oxford University Press.
Ms. Wing Bitfu from Mark Elon Marketing Representative.
Mr. Lee Thugla from Houston's.
We would also like to introduce to you our distinguished guest from Vietnam's National Foreign Language 2020 project, Ms. Nguyen Thi Mai Mu at the Vietnam National Foreign Language 2020 project.
And from the Ho Chi Minh City, Open University, it's my honor to introduce to you the Associate Professor Nguyen Minh Ha, Vice Rector of Ho Chi Minh City Open University.
Dr. Nguyen Thuy Nga, Dean of Faculty of Foreign Languages, Ho Chi Minh City Open University.
Dr. Ho Phi, Junan, the Head of Chinese Department.
Mr. Nguyen Ngoc Anh, Head of the Office of Students Affairs.
Dr. Ho Hu Quy, Dean of the Captain and Auditing Faculty.
From your organizing committee for UBC Open University, once again, we would like to introduce to you Dr. Nguyễn Thúy Nga, Dean of Faculty of Foreign Languages for UBC Open University.
Dr. Mungoro, Head of the Culture, English Linguistics and Translation Institute.
Dr. Nguyễn Thị Xuân Lan, Member.
Ms. Nguyễn Hồ Đăng Tâm, Member.
Ms. Nguyễn Hoa Mai, Secretary.
And Mr. Michael Ding, the Co-Ordinator of the Conference.
For the press, we would like to introduce the newspaper, the Jin newspaper, the Saigon Times, the Lao Dao newspaper, Giáo Dục và Thời Đại newspaper, and HTV.
Ladies and gentlemen, and I would like to introduce to you Associate Professor Nguyễn Minh, the Vice Rector of the Ho Chi Minh City Open University, to the stage for his welcome speech.
Dear distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. First of all, on behalf of Ho Chi Minh City Open University, I welcome all participants from over the world to attend the 6th International Conference of OpenTESOL 2018, hosted by Ho Chi Minh City Open University. Ho Chi Minh City Open University has strong faculty of languages with more than 1,200 students on campus and more than 1,500 distance students. We provide programs from bachelor degree, master degree, and PhD degree. Every year, we have many activities to improve teaching and doing research, and this conference is one of these. The conference gathered here with more than 200 participants from 30 universities to exchange and share experience and knowledge on the exciting field of language, learning and teaching in the post-matter phase. We are very proud to be host of this highly regarded conference for the 6th time, the first time in 2013. We would like to thank very much all members of organizers and scientific committee. They work very hard for this conference. And finally, I would like to wish the conference successful and all of you have a significant conference day. Thank you very much. All the best to you.
Thank you very much, Associate Professor Nguyễn Minh.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's our great honor as well today to welcome all lecturers, teachers, postgraduate students, undergraduate students from the departments of English, Chinese, and Japanese from 28 universities, colleges, and educational institutes across the country.
This is the Ho Chi Minh City University of Education.
Phạm Ngọc Thạch University of Medicine.
Thái Nguyên University.
Ho Chi Minh City University of Natural Resources.
University of Languages and International Studies, Vietnam National University, Hanoi.
Ho Chi Minh City University of Technology.
University of Social Sciences and Humanities, Vietnam National University, Ho Chi Minh City.
Hanoi Pedagogical University too.
Nha Trang National College of Pedagogy.
Cần Thơ University,
Bình Dương University,
Phan Lan University,
Gia Viễn English Language Center,
British University Vietnam,
Đồng Tháp University,
College of Foreign Languages Huế University,
Cô Cụ Trẻ University the USA,
Palu University,
An Giang University,
University of Đà Nẵng,
University for Economics, Ho Chi Minh City, Open University,
Banking University, Ho Chi Minh City,
University of Agriculture and Veterinary Medicine in Hokkaido, Hokkaido, Japan.
Military Academy.
Nagoya University, Japan.
Monash University, Australia.
Meiko University.
And now we would like to invite Professor Mark Helgesen, Associate Professor Lei Mangan, and Dr. David Campbell to get to the stage to receive flowers from our host.
And I would like to invite Dr. Minh, the Dean of the Faculty of Foreign Languages at Ho Chi Minh City Open University, to the stage to deliver the flowers to the keynote speakers. Thank you, all of the three keynote speakers and Dr. Minh Ping An. Dr. Minh Ping An, please remain on the stage for a while to present flowers to our sponsor, the Regional Language, English Language Office. And we would like to invite Ms. Diane Miller to the stage to receive flowers from our host. Thank you very much, Mrs. Diane Miller and Dr. Minh Ping An. Ladies and gentlemen, we would like to invite representatives from Oxford University Press, Mark Miller, Pearson Education Vietnam, to get to the stage to receive the flowers from our host. And I would like to invite Dr. Win Goffin Hong to have the Cultures and Linguistics and Translation Interpretation Department to the stage to deliver the flowers.
Thank you. And next we would like to invite Dr. Minh Ping An to get to the stage to have a few words right, to officially get the conference started. Please welcome Dr. Minh Ping An.
Their presentation and arranging their promote friendship and cooperation among the conference participants. We also would like to take this opportunity to express our thanks to Ms. Jan Miller, Director of Regional English Language Office from the U.S. Embassy in Hanoi, and all the publishers for their support and their contributions to the conference. We also want to thank all the conference organizing committee members for your endless efforts to make this event possible. To all the conference participants, we truly value your participation and involvement in this conference. Thank you again for your meaningful presence and participation. I wish all of the presenter participants a very happy day today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Minh and Dean of the Faculty of Foreign Languages of the University. I would like to introduce to you Ms. Diane Miller from Regional English Language Center, who is going to the stage at some moment.
Xin chào, good morning. Thank you. That's all my Vietnamese, unfortunately. Dr. Minh Minh Han, Vice Rector of Ho Chi Minh City Open University. Dr. Minh Thuy Nha, Dean of Faculty of Foreign Languages. Dr. Minh Mai Hieu from Project NFL 2080. Distinguished plenary speakers, organizing committee, sponsors, presenters, and teachers. I am delighted to be here on behalf U.S. government this morning to welcome you to the 6th OpenTESOL conference held at Ho Chi Minh City Open University. The U.S. government, through the Regional English Language Office, provides scholarship, materials, resources, and exchange opportunities for English language teachers throughout Vietnam. And if you would like more information about our programs, I encourage you to visit the U.S. Embassy website. But why? Why does the U.S. government support English language teachers? Why would we invest our money doing this? Well, of course, as you all know, English is a global language, and it is a way to communicate in our new global economy. That is one reason. But I think there are more important reasons. Second, I think all English language teachers are lifelong learners. We continue learning about our profession and learning how to become better and better teachers. For this, I believe, don't tell the math teachers, don't tell the science teachers, but I believe that English language teachers are the most innovative teachers in their schools and educational institutions. Another reason why we invest in English language teachers is because teachers worldwide make a difference. You make a difference. You make a difference in the lives of your students who you can inspire and help to grow. You make a difference in your schools, and you make a difference in your communities and in your country. So I would like to thank you all for making a difference. I would also just like to kindly thank the Open University of Ho Chi Minh City for organizing this dynamic conference and for inviting us to be part of it today. I would like to thank all of the sponsors for their gracious support, donations to the Lucky Draw, and for supporting English language teachers. I certainly would like to thank all of the organizing committee for their many, 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 many hours of work that they have put into this conference. I'd also like to thank the student volunteers who are running around downstairs. chairs handing out tags and being so helpful and cheery. But finally, last but not least, I would like to thank all of the presenters and the participants who have given up yet another Saturday, we always give up Saturdays, teachers, to come to Ho Chi Minh City and to invest in your own professional development and your lifelong learning. Thank you all for making a difference in your school and in your communities. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Diabino. Please remain on the stage for a while. Ladies and gentlemen, to make today's special moments become tomorrow's memories, we would like to invite all of the three keynote speakers, our sponsor from the Regional English Language Office, Oxford University Press, Pearson Education Vietnam, Mark Millen, our distinguished guest, Ms. Wimpy Maibu, and the organizing committee of OpenTESOL to proceed to the stage for the group photos.
He's Associate Professor Minh and Dr. Minh.
Biodata, our first keynote speaker, Professor Mark Helgesen.
Distinguished guest, ladies and gentlemen, Mark Helgesen is author of over 180 books, textbooks, and professional articles, including Pearson Popular English First-Hand Series. He has been an invited speaker at development workshop on five continents. He teaches at Miyagi Gakuin Women's University, Sendai, Japan, and in the MA TESOL program at Nanyang University of Foreign Studies. And now, welcome to Professor Mark Helgesen.
And
now you want us to be responsible for happiness? I don't think it's responsibility. I really think it's opportunity. But the reason, one of the reasons I think it's so important is everyone in this room deals with psychology, educational psychology, every day. Now you could either deal with it with awareness, with thought, with mindfulness, or you can deal with it by default, but we are dealing with it. And so it's worth thinking about. It's also worth remembering that, and the research is there, happy students learn more. And you know that in your own experience. Happy students work longer on tasks and approach those tasks with more enthusiasm. Yeah? And we know that while all this stuff is going on, there's some interesting things going on in their minds. Sean Aker, who used to teach at Harvard, describes the neurons in your brain as learning centers. And he says that when we're happy, you're getting this dopamine rush, and your learning centers, your neurons are lighting up. It's kind of like the equalizer on your stereo when you crank up the volume. And that's what we want to do in our classroom. Now, I should explain, what is positive psychology? Fairly new field of psychology, it is not the power of positive thinking. That's philosophy, it's not science. It is the study of happy, mentally healthy people. But a traditional psychology has focused on mental illness, on problems, on depression, schizophrenia, all those problems. And that remains important. So positive psychology is not a replacement, but positive psychology focuses on mental health. But 20 years ago, some people in the psychology movement said, you know that old joke, but it's late at night and there's this guy outside under a street light looking for something, and somebody says, did you lose something? Yeah, I lost my keys. Well, where did you lose them? Over there somewhere. Well, why are you looking here? The light's better. Because we're not gonna find out about mental health by studying mental illness. We find out about mental health by learning what's going on with happy, mentally healthy people. Now, why part of English language teaching? It doesn't have to be. It's not like vocabulary and grammar and functions and reading and writing and, you know, the things we have to teach. But, as I said, any teaching includes educational psychology. Happy students do better. And we're talking about engaging, personalized, multisensory activities. And those trigger dopamine, which triggers focus, memory, and motivation. And why part of English language teaching? Well, for many students, education is a pressure cooker. Yeah? Tests are so important. And we often don't have time for the positives. Why part of English language teaching? Well, we teach English, but we don't just teach English. We teach people, yeah? For me, this is a logical part of humanistic language teaching. I want to stress, though, this is not a magic answer. Yeah, I mean, we're not talking like, you know, Harry Potter and the keys to English. It's not that. It is simply a set of tools. Tools that we can use to make our teaching better. Positive psychology is about finding out what happy, mentally healthy people do. Yeah? And the good news is scientists know. And if scientists know, we can know. And if we can know, how do we get that information to our students? Well, my answer is dictation. Can you look in your bag and you have a handout that looks like this? It says ELT in the Science of Happiness. Yeah. Yeah. Dictation. Do you use dictation?
Yeah.
A few go look. A couple of people are raising their hands. Some people are raising their hands kind of secretly. Like you don't want to admit it. I mean, because dictation, you know. If you use dictation, does that make you
you a dictator. It has that energy, doesn't it? But I like dictation. For short, it's a great way to get short pieces of information across. So how this works, you have your hand up, and then you say, thank you. You say, what number? Number one. And you say, and I say, remember good things in your life. And you write, remember good things in your life. Okay? And now, can the person at the end of the row pass these strips down the row? Yeah, everybody gets one, should be enough. Yeah, yes. Everybody take one. Okay? And when you get your sentence, please copy it onto your paper. Yeah? So please write the missing words.
Yeah. Yeah, hand them down. Yeah. Good, good, good.
You see, this is a peer dictation. Usually dictation, the teacher says everything, but in this, it's a student-to-student dictation. In this case, teacher-to-teacher dictation. Now, the next part is important. You've written your sentence. If anybody didn't get one, just share with your neighbor. You've written your sentence. Now, the important thing is, take it and crunch it up. Throw it away. Because it's a student-to-student dictation. And if you don't throw away the paper, what happens is they say, what's your sentence? Here you are. And it's no longer a dictation. Okay? Now, can you turn to the person next to you, say, what number? Say, what's your sentence? And dictate the sentence to the person next to you. Go.
That positive
cycle. And in a world where everyone, and especially everything, your telephone and your computer, is trying to sell you something about you, thinking about other people is important. Happy people take time for friends and family. And I feel so sad every time I walk into a coffee shop or a restaurant and I see young people sitting together. And they could be on different planets. When you're with your friend, put your phone away. Be with your friend. When you're with your family, be with your family. Happy people learn to forgive. Forgive others and forgive themselves. Yeah, we work with young people. And young people, I'm thinking teenagers here, by age 15, the limbic system in the brain, that's the part that controls emotion, anger, stuff like that, is fully developed. But the prefrontal cortex, the executive part of the brain, is not. That's one reason young people do stupid stuff. Yeah, they can have full anger like an adult, but they don't control it as well. So young people take risks. And as a result, they need to be able to forgive themselves. Stay healthy. Regular exercise can be as strong in dealing with depression as psychiatric drugs. Happy people notice good things when they happen. This is different than remembering. This is real time. This is mindfulness. And happy people find ways to deal with problems. It could be friends. And by the way, if you need friends, Facebook doesn't count. Friends, meditation, religion, social support. There are lots of ways to do it, but you need a system. But when I first came across this list is from Sonia Lubomirsky, University of California, Riverside. And when I came across this list about a dozen years ago, what struck me as we're English teachers. We already do a lot of this stuff. Yeah? I mean, things like friends and family, and health. Those are very common textbook topics, right? And things like, remember, that's grammar. It's gotta be past tense. Notice things as they happen. It's present or present habitual or something like that. Functions, thanking, forgiving, those are language functions, language routine. Now, if we're dealing with this stuff anyway, wouldn't it be better to deal with it? So much class time is spent with, you know, who's your favorite movie star? What's your hobby? And there's nothing wrong with those topics, but this gives us a chance to go so much deeper. Okay, I have a website, elt.andhappiness.com, and there's tons of free downloadable lessons, all of which connect to positive psychology points and a clear teaching point. So I invite you there. But about 10 years ago, Martin Seligman, University of Pennsylvania, and he's one of the founders of the positive psychology movement, released a model called PERMA. And PERMA is kind of like happiness 2.0. It's more sophisticated. And PERMA stands for positive emotion. Because scientists don't talk about happiness because it's too loose. And it doesn't sound serious. So they call it positive emotion, engagement, relationships, meaning, meaningfulness, and accomplishment. Some people call it agency. And this is what we need to flourish. And I'd like to briefly look at each of these and ways we might use them in our own classroom. I do an activity. Your students all have cell phones. In class, is that a good thing or a bad thing? Good thing. Bad thing. Some students, a few years ago, we've all said about put your phone away, right? But I try to make use of the phones. And one activity I do is I say, okay, guys, for next week, for the next class, I'd like you to take pictures of five good things in your life, five things that make your life worthwhile. Now, do not take 100 pictures and show us five, because that's what they tend to do. Only take five, because I want you to slow down. I want you to really think about it. And then they come back and talk about it. And there's more to that I'll explain. But, so I have five, I'll give an example of five things in my life, but for time I'm just going to show you one. I'm going to show you one picture of something good in my life and ask you to ask me a couple of WH questions, okay? And the good thing in my life is barbecue. But it might be a little different than what you're used to. This is how I made barbecue. I did it home recently. Any questions? I'm sorry? My family. Who did I have barbecue with? My family. But any questions about stuff in the picture? I did this a couple days ago at a different university, and somebody said, those look like big beans. They're bananas. Have you ever had barbecue bananas? They're wonderful. You take a banana, slice it in half, take a spoon, put a few little holes in it, put in blueberries and raspberries and any kind of berries, a little cinnamon, smoke it, put in like apple chips or cherry chips, and smoke it for about 20 minutes, it's yummy. And somebody said, what's the meat? Chicken, yeah. And what's the yellow stuff? Marshmallows, no. Mango. Because mango is a natural meat tenderizer. Try the chicken, it's wonderful. Anyway, that's just an example, but the important thing is the WH questions. Now in a minute, I'm gonna ask you to do this very quickly, but let me explain why WH questions are important, both from a teaching point of view and from a psychology point of view. When you ask WH questions, it's a discourse strategy. We're helping the learner keep the conversation going. And we all know students who are not good at keeping the conversation, who just answer the question, what's your name, Mark? Where are you from? Japan. What do you like to do in your free time for you? The conversation is painful, right? Asking WH questions keeps it going. And from a psychological point of view, WH questions about a positive experience or event leads to what's called an active constructive response. Because how we respond makes a difference. I'd like you to imagine your partner, and your partner might be your life partner, husband, wife, it might be your boyfriend, girlfriend, or it might be your partner in a classroom activity, just gets a job promotion, okay? And then you see them say, oh, I got promoted. And an active, constructive response, you say, wow, great, tell me all about it. How did you hear? What are you going to be doing? You're inviting the speaker to go deeper into it. But some people do a passive constructive response. Got a job promotion. Wow, great. That's nice. Yeah. And some people even do a passive destructive response. Yeah. That's nice. What's for dinner? And there's such a thing as an active destructive response. Got a job promotion. Oh, great. Now you're going to be even busier than you are now. Right? So how you respond makes a difference. So what I'd like to ask you to do is take out your phone. Seriously. I'm an English teacher. I'm not going to let the audience sit for 50 minutes. And open to any photo that you want to share. And show it to the person next to you, partner, ask WH questions. Okay, we'll spend about 2 minutes doing this. I should emphasize one thing though. Whenever I do this, I have little cards. cards like this that say, this is for students who either don't have a cell phone, which is nobody, whose cell phone, the battery died, who some people just don't want to show pictures or don't take pictures. But I especially never want anybody embarrassed because they don't have the coolest smartphone, right? So I ask them, don't draw a picture, just describe it. Okay, so can you, we'll spend about 2 minutes on this, turn to the person next to you, show them the picture from your phone, ask WH questions.
Grazie. So I want to say grazie to Italy because they gave
Vietnam for Yeah? Because they build in small, the stress, and then accomplishing that goal gives you a small reward. And that's how they get addicted, right? Because they're really good at that. We need stress. All right, relationships, which for us as teachers, we're talking teacher-student relationship and student-student relationship, and they're both very, very important. And one thing that I find hard, I mean, how many students do you have? And for most of us, it's a lot, right? Often in the hundreds. And like, my students have maybe 20, 25 teachers who are young, old, male, female, I mean, all this range, right? I teach in a women's university, so I have like 250 students, all of whom are Japanese women between 18 and 22 years old. Except that one Vietnamese woman who's my student. But how do you learn names? Yeah. Names are really, really hard. The way I try to do it, or at least, you know, try to learn names, is have them make name cards like this. On the inside, they write a biography, a mini bio, and I say, write something weird. Do not say, I'm 18 years old, I graduated from high school last year, and I like pop music. Because that's everybody, right? This student, she just graduated last year, so she's like 24 now, maybe. She said, I love to listen to 70s and 90s music like ABBA, Madonna, stuff like that. I thought, that's weird. Turns out when she was a little girl, her dad gave her an ABBA CD. And she just fell in love with this strange sound in this language she didn't understand. She fell in love with ABBA, fell in love with English, and now she's bilingual. I learned her name really, really quickly. I go to class about 2 minutes. I collect the cards every week. I go to class 2 minutes early and start passing them out because it puts positive stress on me. It forces me to learn the names. I'm trying to build rapport. And that's my main point here about relationship. Rapport doesn't just happen, we make it happen. And some teachers, have you heard the expression, don't smile until second semester? Maybe not, because people smile in Vietnam a lot, right? But it's very common in the West. Don't smile until second semester. No, start out tough. Let them know they can't get away with anything. So I start out with this kind of thing. Is that who I want to start in my relationship? Maybe not. It has to do with the brain. Yeah, with the part of the brain called the amygdala. I mean, one of the reasons you are here today is because sometime, and I don't mean you're here at this conference, I mean the reason you exist is sometime in the past, you know, 30,000 years ago on the plains of Africa, your ancestors came across danger. Yeah? And the amygdala controls the fight, flight, or freeze response. And I don't know what your ancestors did. They threw rocks at that fight, or they ran away, or they froze because predators can't see it. But your ancestors did something right. Somebody else's ancestors didn't understand the danger. And they, long story short, they became lunch. Your ancestors became survivors. Now, most of us are not stupid enough to put ourselves in that kind of situation, but example of stress. The terrible attacks on 9/11. How many people died? Just not in the wars, but just in that. Yeah, about 3,000. But do you know about the other 1,595? That's the number of people who died of stupidity. They refused to get on airplanes in the next year, and they died in car and bus crashes. Because airplanes are, all in the United States, because airplanes are always safer, right? But stress. When we are stressed or overstressed, fear overrides new learning. So I'd like to try an experiment, and I'm learning this for a couple of reasons. Number one, you've been sitting down a long time. And when we sit, this is something I was talking about in session yesterday, when you sit for 20 minutes, blood goes south. builds up in feet, lower legs, and butt. When you stand up for 1 minute, there's a 15% increase in blood and therefore oxygen to the brain. So can I ask you to stand up? And turn to the person next to you. And in each pair, one of you is A. A, please raise your hand. The other person is B. People are looking, which do I want to be? I don't know. Don't worry, nobody's going to be here. A, your job is a very fierce frown. B, your job is a big smile. This is a stare-off. I want to see who wins. Frowning person, do you smile? Or smiling person, do you frown? Which one's more, which one's stronger?
Don't worry, Mark, you're not not in trouble. I said, I'm not. And he said, no, the reason I called you in is it's time to sign up for classes for next year. And Mark, you should consider child development. Now what you need to understand, this is long, long ago. And back then, we had boys' classes, like auto mechanics, wood shop, and girls' classes, like home economics, cooking, and child development. Child development was a girls' class. I said, child development, he said, Mark, you should think about being a teacher. I took it for totally the wrong reason. It was a girls' class, and a good odds. But it was fascinating. So I'm the youngest of my family, so I never had younger brothers or sisters. And I learned all about development, and Piaget, and Erickson, and all this cool stuff. It was fascinating. So that was my second year of high school. My third year of high school, I became a teacher's aide. I spent every afternoon at an elementary school helping and pretending to be a teacher. And it was great. And then I went to university and became an education major. And then I went to grad school for TESOL. And the reason I'm here today is because of Fred Stevens. He was my mentor. He started me on. And so about 10 years ago or so, I wrote him a gratitude letter. Dear Principal Stevens, you were my principal back in 1970-something. And I explain what he did. And I tell my students this story, and they write a gratitude letter to someone, usually a parent, but it can be anybody. And you can see this in your handout. It tells them how to write a letter, a thank you letter, in English. And they write it twice. They write it once in English, and once in my case, Japanese, since I'm in Japan. But they write it in the language of whoever did the nice thing, okay? And at the top it says, in my English class, we've been talking about important people and events in our lives. My teacher asked me to write a gratitude letter to someone who helped me. I decided to write to you. And you'll notice on the slide, we have the Vietnamese on the left-hand side. When I sent the file for your handout a couple of weeks ago, I didn't yet have the Vietnamese version. This version's on my website. You can download it, print it out, use it with your students. And in my case, the students come in, I print it on a big piece of paper, A3 or B4, and English on one side, first language on the other side. And they come to class, and I cut it in half, and I give them an envelope. And most of them, as I said, are writing to their parents. If they're writing to somebody else, I give them a stamp. And the students are like, really? Because they think it's just an exercise. And I said, it's up to you. But in most cases, the students share the letter with the person. And I've heard some beautiful stories. I've heard stories that students say, and I live in Japan, you don't usually express emotion this directly. But the letter kind of gives them permission. And I've heard students have come back and said, I read this to my mom, and we just cried together. And tears of joy. And you never know what's going to happen. I remember one student said, I read it to my dad, and he looked at me and said, what did you do to the car? Right, so you don't know what will happen, but most of the experiences are really, really positive. Last one, accomplishment, agency. Students very often feel they don't control their own future. How can we break it down? I mean, it's not enough to say, oh yeah, I want to be really good at English. I mean, that's good, but that's too broad, too big. Let me give you an idea of breaking it down. Accomplishment, setting goals. I travel quite a bit. Like I come to a lot of conferences. And usually my wife doesn't want to come along. So the first time I came to Vietnam, she did. But after that, I'm not going to go. Because she says, Mark, you just go to the conference, and then you and your friends sit around and talk about language teaching. And I'm like, well, yeah. And I don't know why, but she doesn't find that fascinating. But few years ago, I was going to a conference in England. And she said, okay, England, I'm going to that one, and we're going to stop in Italy. And I said, good, now we'll have to figure out how much it's going to cost. And she said, don't worry, that's covered. And I said, pardon? See, what had happened, she had decided I was probably going to get invited to England. So she went to, you know, Daiso, the shop that sells cheap stuff. She went to Daiso and got one of those bangs, tin can bangs that you can only open one time. And every time she got a 500 yen coin. 500 yen is about $100,000, okay? So not small, but not it's our biggest coin. Every time she got one of those coins, she would save it. Because it's very hard to save a couple thousand dollars that you need to go to Europe. But it's easy to save $100,000 at a time, right? And she had broken her goal down so that she could achieve the goal. And that's how accomplishment achievement agency works. Quick memory check. As teachers, we need to remember spaced repetition. You don't want the students just saying it immediately. I told you this acronym about 35, 40 minutes ago. Turn to your partner, what's PERMA mean? Positive psychologist says, There are only two kinds of people who don't have bad things happen in their lives. Psychotics, crazy people, and the dead. Okay? We're gonna have negative things happen. I tell students, and I don't say this is gonna make you happy, I said, just notice what's happening. Notice what happens. Yeah. And accept whatever you get. But I think it's a danger. Don't set unrealistic expectations, because the human mind is way too complex for that. But thank you, that's a good point.
Thank you.
So one more picture from the audience, please. I'd like to chance for you to raise your picture to Professor Bart Helgesen. All right, so if you don't have any questions for Professor Mark Harrison, please, Professor Mark Harrison, please remain on the stage for a while. And next, we would like to invite Dr. Minh to get to the stage to present a certificate of appreciation to Professor Mark Harrison. Remain on the stage for a while. Thank you. Please get back to the stage, and we would like to invite our sponsors from the Regional English Language Office, Oxford University Press, ESM Education Vietnam, and Mark Elon, our distinguished, and to get to the stage to receive a certificate for the sponsors, please.
Speakers, distinguished guests, all the members, organizing members, and all the lecturers, participants, students to the stage to have a group photo as a user.
Ladies and gentlemen,
Ladies and gentlemen, please be noted that our parallel session takes place in the following rooms stated in the OpenTESOL program. The main hall on the second floor, room 604, room 602, room 4202, room 444, room 505, room 702 for the Chinese sessions, and room 704 for the Chinese sessions. You are expected to get back to the concurrent session at 10:30.
Let's have